We're now ready to open up for questions. If anyone has any? Go ahead. Yes.
Are there any concrete examples of President Trump favoring his private interests over his public duty?
Ben, do you want, I mean, Ron, do you want to take that?
Yes, the question being concrete examples of President Trump favoring his private interest over public duties. You know, one of the most striking examples actually came during the election season with respect to Trump Towers in Istanbul, where he has two buildings, actually a pair. And Trump, over the course of the election campaign, was on the up and then on the down with the president of Turkey. So when he first called for a ban on Muslim immigration to the United States, the president of Turkey said the name Trump should be removed from those office towers. Then a little while later, when there was an attempted coup in Turkey, Donald Trump at that point said, well, actually, I support the president. And then the president of Turkey all of a sudden dropped his demand that the name Trump be removed from the towers. And Trump said at that point, he actually said to a reporter, I have a little conflict of interest with respect to Turkey because I have two office buildings there. So this is a perfect example of how in a problematic region of the world where there are very complex interests of the United States involved with a country that's an ally, but where there's also some tension, how Trump's swings of policy, where he admitted that he had a conflict of interest, seemed to be dictated by the prospect of having his name removed from an office building.
And Ben Clements also, I think, is going to address this.
So just to respond a little bit, elaborate on what Ron said. Now, these direct connections, of course, are very hard to definitively prove. But there is evidence from which compelling inferences can be made. Take, for example, President Trump's recent attempts to ban people from certain countries coming into our country, supposedly based on fear of terrorism. The countries whose people were banned included a series of countries in the Middle East from which no person is known to have ever committed a terrorist act resulting in the death of any American. Excluded from the ban were several countries, including Saudi Arabia, which of course has had a number of people responsible for terrorist deaths of Americans, including many of the 9/11 hijackers, and several other Middle Eastern countries that all had one thing in common. And that one thing in common is that Donald Trump does business in each of those countries. He doesn't do business in any of the countries that were included in his ban. So you can, one can argue there may have been other reasons, but it's striking how those line up, and the inferences, as I said, are compelling. But the broader point that I'd like to make is the reason, as Professor Ross outlined so well, that the framers felt it important to put these ironclad rules regarding foreign and domestic emoluments in the Constitution is because of the difficulty in establishing that an officer or the president in particular's judgment has been compromised. And so it's not up to us to prove that. If the president is taking foreign emoluments, the Constitution essentially creates a presumption that his judgment will be impaired. And that's the reason we're calling on Congress to impeach or begin an impeachment investigation.
Thank you, Ben. Any other questions?
Is there any precedent that a petition has worked to get a president impeached?
Well, to be clear, maybe Norman, do you want to take this question? I'll start, and then to add, to be clear, we're not saying that the petition alone is the basis for impeachment. We're asking for an impeachment investigation to proceed, for Congress to do its job of subpoenaing records, putting people under oath, and demonstrating whether or not the president has committed impeachable offenses. This is the start of the impeachment process, but not the conclusion of it. But Norman, do you want to add to that?
Yes, to briefly elaborate on that, The petition and the names on the petition all gathered since Inauguration Day when the violation of the Constitution's Foreign and Domestic Emoluments Clauses began. Those names are markers, they're indicators, they're reflections of widespread concern, anger, and commitment from people around the country. And so, broadly in answer to your question, there is precedent in terms of impeachment when those conditions exist and grow, as they're now growing in this country, to demand that the House of Representatives take action in the form of impeachment. And we lived through that period, those of us who are old enough to remember 1973 and 1974. That's really the dynamic. When at first the Watergate stories and the concerns were considered to be marginal, considered to be unrealistically projected to cause major political problems for then President Nixon, and the willingness and increasing commitment of people around the country to say this is not tolerable resulted in the House Judiciary Committee taking impeachment action. And I think that's a path, those are footsteps that we now, loosely speaking, have begun to walk in.
Any other questions? Yes.
I think a lot of people who might be sympathetic to you, the name Pence pops into their head. How do you respond to that?
Well, I'll start and then I'll please ask others if they want to add to that. Our position, and we've answered this question on our website via our FAQ document, is that the removal, the impeachment and removal of the President of the United States will be clearly upholding our Constitution and our democracy. And any person becoming president as a result of that process, vice president becoming president, will be under even greater scrutiny to comply with the Constitution and the rule of law. Furthermore, it would be a very dangerous precedent to allow a president to trample on the Constitution, as this president is doing, and not hold him accountable through that process via the impeachment proceedings. So our position is that we need to uphold the Constitution and the rule of law here, and the follow-up will be that we have a stronger democracy for it.
There's increasing and I think well-founded concern that the United States government is careening towards dictatorship. And among the most important facets of dictatorship is that somebody at the top can flagrantly and with impunity violate the law. And by its own description, the Constitution of the United States is the supreme law of the land. So I think that becomes sort of job one for people, to make sure that this perhaps imminent occurrence doesn't actually happen. And the belief, and I certainly share it, is that if impeachment and then conviction by the Senate takes place, that the person who steps into the Oval Office, in this case, Mr. Pence, will be under great and recently demonstrated restraints and constraints to show that this is not going to fly as a country where the wealthy and powerful can say that the laws don't apply to them from the very top of the Oval Office. So from a principled standpoint of preserving democracy and preventing dictatorship, it's a no-brainer. It's necessary to impeach Trump. From a political calculus, I think we could say with great justification that it's much better to have a successor in the White House who knows that the Congress and the people have just shown they won't tolerate flagrant violations of the Constitution, rather than doing some sort of calculus to accept a status quo that should be intolerable.
Professor Ross, do you want to answer this question or any other matters that have come up thus far?
I'll just add to that, because a number of people have asked me that question. And my response is that that shows that this is not about politics. This is not about being disgruntled about who won the election. Because if you were to look at it from a political standpoint, Vice President Pence is a very conservative man. And I'm not thinking about the legislative proposals that he would put forward. He probably, you know, knowing the Constitution, knowing the government, would be more effective at pursuing his agenda than President Trump seems to be. But that isn't the issue here. This is about the fundamental constitutional structure of our government and preserving democracy. Because once you say that we're not even going to try to rein in this president, he's one of a kind, you lower the bar, and it becomes very impossible, very, very difficult to enforce rule of law in the future. We can't afford that.
Thank you very much. Any other questions? If not, thank you for coming. We invite Americans all over the country who have yet to join this campaign to join us at impeachdonaldtrumpnow.org. We'll be delivering these petitions this afternoon to Congress. Thank you.